diseases, who has delivered your life from the grave and crowned you with loving kindness and tender mercies and renewed your youth like the eagles. With this opening line from Psalm 103, verses 1 to 5, Jerusha is here to lead us in prayer with a song.
Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer that calls me from a world of care and bids me at my Father's throne, make all my wants and wishes known. Soul has often found relief, and all this grace, the temple's
there.
I'm so sorry, ma'am. I just didn't notice it.
No, no. Please continue where you're.
Sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer that calls me from a world of
Thank you, Jerusha. That was lovely. And I now request Sangeeta to give us a short intro to IJN. We are delighted to have them with us once again.
Thank you, ma'am. It's always been a pleasure to collaborate with your college. Let me introduce IJN. The Indian Institute of Journalism and New Media is one of South Asia's leading postgraduate colleges of journalism and media. Located in Bangalore, in the heart of India's high-tech industry, the Institute offers an excellent curriculum that combines both theory and practice to prepare its graduates for positions in the media industry. We offer a curriculum developed in association with Columbia University Graduate School of Journalism, New York. Our programs in print, television, and multimedia journalism embody the best practices in the media industry. Our mission is to educate students in a broad range of practical skills and concepts involving gathering, editing, and presenting of information. Every year, IJNM conducts a series of lectures in cities across the country with the aim of increasing awareness about the field of journalism. We're honored to be conducting this national webinar today in collaboration with St. Ann's. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sangeeta. Sangeeta, like me, is part of her English department of IJNM, and she's heading it, Professor Sangeeta. She's also a poetry enthusiast, as I have seen, and she writes a lot of poetry. And we are delighted to know that, because we are a lot of literature enthusiasts besides language enthusiasts in this 8-member department. So St. Ann's College is accredited with an A+ grade in its third cycle by the UGC, and it has been awarded this college with potential for excellence. It's an autonomous college affiliated to OU. It's situated in the city of Pearls, Hyderabad. It's a stone's throw from High Tech City, the hub of technology. It's about 30 plus years old, and it has a nearly 3,000 student strength. So at St. Anne's, you have a vibes of tradition and vigor of youthful energy. This is basically a UG college, and it has all the faculties of life sciences, arts, and commerce. And we are happy to say that this year we have introduced journalism as one of the options on the BA, BA platter. So that's, but journalism has always been a passion and an interest for all students all over the college. And right now, I also want to give you a brief overview of the department. That is, we have Ms. Sarita, who is a part of the IQAC. We have Ms. Rashmi, who has a corporate responsibility of attendance and looking into timetables. We have Ms. Revati, who heads the health center. We have Ms. Dr. Kanaka, who heads the literary committee. We have Pratyusha, who looks into online timetables. And Vani, of course, who takes care of our software needs, which are imperative now. And Betty is our newest entrant, working on her PhD on ELT. So that's a brief overview of us. And now it's over to the students. As the first one to go will be an intro to Ms. Rishika Salam.
Can you please? Yeah.
Good morning, everyone. I'll be introducing Ms. Rishika. Rishika Sadam is an alumna of the Indian Institute of Journalism and New Media. She has been in the industry for 7 years. She is currently a special correspondent with The Print and heads the Telangana and Andhra Pradesh bureaus. From politics to policies to governance to crime, sports and civic issues, all that's happening in the two states is covered by her. Prior to The Print, she was a TV reporter with CNN News 18, handling both the Telugu-speaking states. She started off her career with Reuters as a business journalist and covered tech giants such as Facebook, Twitter, Google, etc. Startups and enterprise cloud companies were also a part of her niche. That's all, Ms. Rishika.
Can we move on to our next panelist, that we, Mr. Mithun? An intro to Mr. Mithun, please.
Yes, ma'am. Good morning, everyone. I'm going to introduce Mr. Mithun MK. Mithun graduated from the Indian Institute of Journalism and New Media in 2016 after a course in multimedia journalism. Though assigned transport lead in the Hyderabad Bureau of the New Indian Express, he had covered civil supply, cybersecurity, and cybercrimes for the paper. He shifted to the News Minute as a senior reporter in 2018 and currently oversees the Dial section, which focuses on long-form, in-depth reportage. St. Anne's is honored to welcome you to the seminar, sir. Thank you very much.
And over to an intro to Mr. Paul Oman.
Good morning. I'm Kirti Sutravi, and welcome to the national seminar organized by the Department of English at St. Anne's College for Women. I would like to take this opportunity to introduce Mr. Paul Oman. Paul Oman studied broadcast journalism at IIJNM and graduated in 2015. He began his career at the desk at News 9 and then worked for 4 years in Times Now as the Hyderabad Bureau in charge. He has covered politics, crime, health, etc. For the last 1 year, he has been associated with the News Minute and is presently heading the Andhra Pradesh and Telangana Bureau for the website as a special correspondent. We're pleased to have you here, sir.
Thank you, Thank you.
And ma'am, sorry for the interruption. There's a live streaming also going on with YouTube link, which I've shared it in chat box, ma'am. Kindly, I would like everyone to make a note of it. The YouTube live streaming is going on.
Right. We request Vani to put it on the WhatsApp group so there are people who haven't yet gotten and have a problem with getting into our Zoom meet, then the YouTube link is available on our IHANM WhatsApp group.
Yes, ma'am. Sure, ma'am.
Yeah. And now it's on to an intro to Mr. Dakshinamurthy, senior most on this panel, and also teaching faculty from IIJNM. Over to the intro.
Good morning. I'm Meghna, and I'm going to be introducing Mr. K.S. Dakshinamurthy. Mr. K.S. Dakshinamurthy was a key member of the editorial team that launched the English language version of Al Jazeera news website in 2003. Based in Doha, he wrote extensively on the U.S. invasion of Iraq and West Asian politics. He returned to India in April 2006 to pursue other journalistic and allied interests. Mr. Murthy, who teaches covering international news, science and technology, and political reporting at IIJNM Bangalore, started his career with Sunday Midday in Bangalore in 1983 and went on to work for several media houses, including the Indian Express, the Press Trust of India, Deccan Herald, and the Hindustan Times. He briefly returned to Al Jazeera from 2013 to 2014 and as India Online Editor for its news website. Based in Bangalore, he is Associate Editor at the Federal News website and writes for prominent publications in India and abroad besides involvement in other media-related work. He is also the author of The Anopheles Sting, a book of fiction published in 2013 by Joan Quill. Thank you.
Thank you, Meghna. Thank you to Sangeeta. A big thank you for putting together this dynamic young panel. I request Sarita Samuel to give an intro to our moderator, Professor, Department of Communication, FU. Sarita.
Thank you, ma'am. I take this opportunity to introduce Dr. Srinivas Lankala, moderator for the day. Dr. Srinivas is an assistant professor in the Department of Communication at the English and Foreign Languages University, Hyderabad. Dr. Srinivas coordinates the MA program in Journalism and Mass Communication and teaches courses in Media Research and Video Production. He has a PhD in Communication from the University of Massachusetts and an MA in Communication from the University of Hyderabad. Prior to IFLU, Dr. Lankala has worked with the Indian Institute for Human Settlements, Bangalore, as an academic administrator. And Dr. Lankala's research interests are in the areas of semiotics and critical media studies. His published work deals with media theory, ideology, and representation. Thank you.
Thank you. And now it's over to Sangeeta. Over to Dr. Srinivas Kakarla, and we are waiting for the action.
Okay, so should we have each of the panelists go first, and then I can make some remarks before we start the Q&A. Is that how the schedule is structured, ma'am?
Yes, sir, that sounds good.
Okay. So maybe before I say anything about today's topic, maybe we can just hear from our panelists for their allotted time. And then what I will do is just sum up what they've said and then open it up to questions. So maybe we can start with Professor Dakshinamurthy to start his remarks. So.
Hi, good morning, everybody. Social media, I think it's really, the latest kid on the block. When I started journalism, it was still the old style journalism. There were just newspapers and hardly much of television. In fact, I've seen the progress of the media, gradually. It started with newspapers, then it went on to television. Then you had, the internet, news services, and then now you have, it's really exploded. The point here is that it's really exploded in a sense that it has completely disrupted journalism in many ways. Because there was a time like when, you know, you needed a certain kind of you know, a technology, a certain kind of expertise to be a journalist. Though, of course, anyone is a journalist, you know, whoever reports what they see is, you know, literally a journalist. But then to actually work as a professional journalist, you need certain, you know, training. There are certain ethics that go with it. There is a process by which the whole industry functions. Okay, so this was the way it worked. And even now it works the same way. But what has happened is social media in some ways has split open this entire field called journalism. Because in social media, what you see is that each and everybody who has access to the net is potentially a journalist. And you look out of your window and then, you know, you report what you see. So you become a reporter, or, you know, you respond to somebody, you correct something, you edit something, you become an editor. So, but what has happened is in this, while it is very good in one way, in the sense of democratization of the space, the flip side of this is that there are no controls anymore. And then, you know, what we suddenly realize is that, you know, there were certain facts which we always thought was very sacrosanct, you know. You don't change, or, you know, you don't twist certain things to suit your thinking. But today it has become as simple as having coffee, you know. Just go online, just, you know, write whatever you want out of your imagination. And if it's written well, it can just, you know, go to millions of people. And then you have something that people start discussing about and all that. So the point here is that a lot of vested interests have got into this space. There are, of course, you know, it's not all black. It's really a gray situation, because you also have people who probably would not have had the opportunity to be a journalist or to report. Now they have the opportunity, like a platform is there right there in front of them. So it's a kind of a gray situation. You know, not everybody is using it the way it should be. And then for people like us who have been in mainstream journalism for many years, who have lived, slept, thought, did everything, you know, I mean, it's a 24/7 kind of a job, you know, it's not a 10/5 like a working person. So what has happened is that it's horrifying, actually, to see some of these twists and, you know, the kind of distortions that happen. And then you pick on an issue, you divert attention from the, you know, what needs to be discussed. So, you know, the list goes on, you know. But then what I feel in conclusion is that these are just early days, and then we still have a long way to go. And eventually certain corrections will kick in. And hopefully in the next few years, you know, there might be a kind of a sense of moderation to this whole field. I think that is broadly my intro.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Dakshinamurthy. It was good to hear someone with your experience taking us through this transition that, you know, the media is currently going through. And we can, of course, come back to these very important questions about democratization of media, whether that has really happened, and, you know, the new kinds of roles that journalists are being asked to play in this new environment when we get to the Q&A. But maybe now we can go to Mr. Paul Ooman for his comments.
So. Yeah. Thank you for this opportunity. Let me begin by telling you that social media has in fact transformed the very way journalism has been, because we have heard a lot from seniors in the field like Dakshinamurthy sir. We've been in the field only for the last 5 to 6 years, and in this span of time itself, we have seen how receiving, that is gathering information, putting it together, pitching it to your editor, and also putting it out. We've seen so much transformation in the last 5 to 6 years that we've been in the field. So it's amazing how social media has an impact or influence on journalism. At the same time, like Sir Dakshinamurthy sir said, there is a flip side to it as well. We will speak about how, in terms of gathering, in terms of sharing and pitching, it has changed. But the fact is that at every hierarchy, social media has an influence. It has opened up opportunities for citizens, like Sir was pointing out, in terms of being citizen journalists, putting out information. But the scope that social media has brought, I work for a digital platform. Speaking from experience, the kind of readership that we now have because of social media, it's amazing. If you would have otherwise been limited to a very small audience, but it has opened up a lot of opportunities for journalists in terms of readership, in terms of putting out the story there, in terms of also gathering information and collating it and putting it out. So at every hierarchy, social media has its influence, and it's very interesting to note how what kind of influence it has, and that we'll probably discuss about it.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Paul Uman, for your comments. Now maybe we can hear from Ms. Rishika Sadam from the print. Ma'am.
A very good morning to all of you, and I want to congratulate St.Ann's for now having a separate course category for journalism. Young journalists are always welcome. I myself, I'm just 7 years into the field. Now, if you ask me, there's no straightforward answer to what kind of impact social media has had on journalism. Imagine if the kind of impact social media is having on people, on businesses, in your own homes, people who have not been associated with technology, your own family members are getting news before you. That's happened with us too. There have been several instances where I go out to tell my family a particular news. By then, they're all like, oh, I've seen this already on WhatsApp. So the transition of news, I mean, you know, like Professor Dakshinmurthy sir had spoken about it. He's been in the industry for decades. So he's seen that transition. We're all journalists who entered right at the time it started. And in these 7 years, we've seen a lot of it. We are living in this really, really speed world where news travels really fast. And as a journalist, or if you are competitive enough, there's no option to stay back. You have to keep up with it. So there's no one particular or one straightforward answer of what kind of impact social media has had. It has definitely transformed all our lives in the way we function, in the way we consume news. Also, it has also had a great impact. I mean, you know, a significant amount of impact on how news organizations function. It has forced journalists to work in a particular way. I'm sure Professor Dakshinmurthy sir will agree. Decades ago, for journalists, for reporters, the first thing to do in the morning when you wake up at 6 a.m. or 5 a.m. is to call up your sources in different cities or areas and check up on them for the news or what's happening with the development, and then you can take it forward. But now every journalist is forced to go on social media and note down the developments or look at the developments. There's no option of not being on social media. So the change, the way it actually transformed, the way it has forced news organizations to work, that probably would be discussed later in the time of discussion. That definitely is there. And there's also a flip side to it. There's also a positive side to it. Like, you know, the sir also mentioned that a lot of independent journalists who wouldn't ideally have not had a platform to showcase the work, social media has amplified their work. But the most important quality for any journalist is credibility. These days, a lot of journalists have their social media profiles. So you are putting out your work independent if you're associated with the organization or if you're an independent journalist, and you have your own set of following there. So credibility is really important for any journalist, and that is where the whole risk starts. How do you balance between the speed? Because there's thousands of journalists, a lot of them follow the social media, consume news from there, put it out there, even readers. Nobody's passively waiting probably for a TV channel or an anchor to confirm that news. It's all about Twitter, Facebook, WhatsApp. They're getting the confirmations from there. A lot of independent news organizations are there. They're following them. So you can't just, it's always a clash between the speed as a journalist that you have to look at, and the very important factor that we're looking at is the credibility. So it's a huge area that we are looking at, where there's a whole positive side if used, if used in the right way, but there also comes with a lot of risk associated with it, especially with the journalists today.
Thank you, Ms. Rishika. That whole distinction between old and new media is really playing out these days. You'll see that in the way that, there's a kind of conflict between guardians of old media and what are now seen as upstarts in, web-based media and so on. So we'll get to that important question as well. But now let's hear from Mr. Mithun M.K. from the News Minute.
Hello, hi. Picking up from where Rishika was saying about credibility, most of the job internet reporting, when you pick up the news, when you see the news breaking from the internet, 90% of the job nowadays is mainly fact-checking. Yeah. You have to go down to see where the news actually originated from. So it has come like the point where, as a journalist, you need to pick up certain skills to fact-check. Your ethics, your own organization's ethics, all play into that factor. It could result in you bringing out the news 1 or 2 hours late, but it would be accurate. And that is really important, because what the social media has done is that it has paved way for vernacular media also to have a space in social media. And sometimes there is a very different journalistic standards between organizations and between vernacular media and English media. So all that plays on the ground. So you have to fact check the news at the end of the day before you put it out. And that becomes a very important aspect. So I would like to speak a little bit more further about how vernacular media brings out the news first most of the time. And as an English journalist, you end up fact checking it. That's happening a lot these days. And it needs to be addressed at some level, because otherwise, because you are having a whole section of society which only consumes vernacular news, which is being staying misinformed at certain levels.
I'd quickly like to add on to that point where Mithun had spoken about fact-checking websites. The growing number of fact-checking websites and the support from the crowd. A couple of fact-checking websites are crowd-funded. So the growing support for the fact-checking website from the people and a growing number of them who are verifying what news organizations are doing and also how news circulates on social media should also tell journalists the kind of fake news phenomenon that we are dealing with. So it's not just, so there's a lot of access to information. There's an information overload on social media. A lot of journalists get leads from social media. Sometimes just a tweet makes news. For example, for instance, Elon Musk tweets something that itself becomes a news. Shares and markets react to it. So sometimes just a tweet makes a news. So the growing number of fact-checking websites we are looking at should also tell you what kind of a dark, the flip side to the social media influence on journalism that is happening today, actually.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Mithun and Ms. Rishika for that addition. So before we open it up, before I draw out the panelists into a fuller discussion, maybe I can just sum up some of the the broad streams of what I think we'll be discussing today. So from what the way I can divide what the panelists have briefly said in their opening remarks, we seem to be looking at, we are now living in a kind of a transition period between journalism as we used to know and then this brave new world of online journalism influenced by social media, where social media plays a huge role in two ways. One is, of course, as Ms. Rishika just pointed out in the end, it is the primary source of news today. And we can discuss, how that has changed what journalists do. This idea that journalists would go out into the field, talk to people, pursue leads, has now turned into the pursuit of social media messages, following tweets, keeping up with what, who is saying, what and which site and so on. And so we can discuss how that has changed the craft of journalism, this new kind of online journalism that depends on social media. And before we open it up, we should also remember it need not have been this way. This is like a kind of coincidence that we have social media growing at the same time as this move of journalism to the internet and, the coming of, web-based journalism venues, as well as the move of newspapers and what used to be called old media to the web-based presence. So that is one. The other is, of course, that this is a kind of a double-edged sword, that on the one hand, as Professor Dakshinamurthy and Mr. Paul Lumen and others have pointed out, this has led to, the rise of what we call citizen journalism. It has opened up journalism to people who would not have been able to enter the field earlier, because the barriers to entry were very high for various reasons, class, gender, region, language, and so on. And now this, we see today, it has opened it up. Today, anyone can aspire to be a journalist. Your words on social media carry equal weight as the words of, a senior journalist or some political leader. So in that sense, it has led to a democratization of journalism. And so again, we can discuss from the panelists whether this is a real democratization or whether, there are older social influences at play in this new social media driven journalism as well. And the last broad stream I think we can discuss is how this has changed the public sphere. That is, now that social media has become it has replaced what used to be the public sphere, the place where people go to discuss things, what used to be part of civil society and, in a integral part of a democratic society. Has social media replaced that? And what effect will that have on our political discussions? Today, we can't think of politics without social media, without tweets and Facebook posts and so on. And so that's one other thing we can discuss. And maybe we can end with talking about the skills that this new kind of journalism requires from new entrants, from students who are looking to enter the field. The old kind, and I know this is actually a very exciting time for St. Anne's College to start a journalism program with all the changes that are going on. So we can also talk a little bit about what students now need to acquire. And, of course, fact-checking, distinguishing between news, all these, fake news and actual news, all these skills, what we used to call media literacy are much more important today. But also journalists are now expected to have multiple skills. Now this is the age of convergence and social media. So you're also asked to take photographs, produce video, what used to be, given out to specialized technicians in the old days is now expected of every journalist in the field. So that's another challenge that students will have to face up to when they're entering this field. So maybe we can discuss all of these in turn. So can I just open it up to first talk about this question of democratization? Has social media actually led to a greater democratization of journalism? In your experience as journalists in the field, do you really see newer entrants, especially journalists who are, working in web-based portals that have just come up or in the web presence of older media? Are they people who would not have been journalists under the old system, or has this social media actually opened up the field? So maybe we can start with Professor Dakshinamurthy, and then you can please feel free to jump in the others. So
when we say democratization, what we actually mean is people who earlier didn't have access and now have the access. So let's take some specific examples. For instance, let's take a case of, let's say, a person A filing a complaint against person B. Okay, and then what typically happens is that an FIR is registered, and then the next day, more often than not, you have the newspaper. I'm talking of the olden times, when they would carry the story saying that A did this to B allegedly and this and that. And so basically, whatever was there in the FIR would normally appear, though it is not the right way to do it, but it would come this way. And then suppose somebody who with an vested interest who's filed the FIR, then it's going to be very unfair to the person who's actually been targeted. But what has happened is, today, the same person has other avenues to, he can come directly on social media. He can give his version of what the news is. He can say where the FIR went wrong. So, and then there are takers for this kind of, so what it immediately means is that he has access to media, which earlier was not possible. So, which means that if A files a complaint against B, and then the damage is done, by the time A goes to the editor, speaks and gets space in the newspaper, it's all over. The damage is done, the person is defamed in many ways. So here what happens is that there is a process. So this is a very simple example of how people can have access to the media. Okay, now the point here is that this has helped a lot, because what this has meant is that today you have a surfeit of views, surfeit of facts on any big issue, for instance, and which was never there before. So it is very good for the broader world of news, where journalism is basically what we're dealing with. When you say journalism, you're basically dealing with news. So in that sense, you can look back and see the various kinds of views that appear on social media. And it is very good. It's very good because you get all sides of the story. So at the end of the day, as a journalist, I really would want to get all sides to a story. So That way, the social media gives that kind of avenue to to different people. So I think in that sense, it's very good that today people have the technology, the tools, and it's a very simple kind of you don't need much of a training, for instance, to indulge in this. Or let's take another example. For instance, you have people like Kunal Kamra, you have people like Dhruv Rathi, you have all kinds of these kind of people who have very a very different way of putting across their views on news, on events. This would have been almost been impossible, in an earlier era. So today you have people, coming up with satire, with humor, pulling down the so-called, icons and, the idols and of whatever of society in a very fun kind of way. So this is another example of where, you have the access to the medium so in the end, everybody benefits from these kind of interaction. So I think broadly, democratization, this is what I meant by democracy. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Any others would want to add to that? Yeah.
I'd like to add something. So when you talk about democratization, I also feel that accountability now plays a lot of this thing. For example, very often we cover Andhra and Telangana. So very often when we miss out a story or we are working on a story, we haven't put it out yet. There are a lot of people on social media who actually tag the organization, tag us and ask how come this story has not been put out. So that's the kind of accountability readers have. Earlier, when it was the newspaper, you check the newspaper. If it's not there, you didn't know what else happened or what was missed by the media. But now people are so fast that they are actually holding journalists, they're holding them accountable. Very often they say Amravati protest at the rate of parliament, you haven't covered. So we may be working on it, but that's the kind of accountability that they expect. Or that's the kind how fast they are. Let me give a very localized example from Hyderabad. There was a case, this is for all the students. There was a case yesterday or day before when from Kukkadpally, a couple was harassed for actually getting their pet to the community. And the association actually, they denied saying you cannot get the pet inside the building. So they went and filed a complaint. No action was taken by the police. On the fourth day after the complaint was filed, they took it to social media. And after it went viral, the police had to actually take action. And now we're hearing that a case is being registered. So that, again, social media is helping people in a lot of way to bring not only issues to the media, but in case media doesn't pick it up, they have their own platform to actually bring it out. So giving them also the power in their hands.
So it's not, I'd like to add a point there actually.
Yeah, Rishika.
So it's not just for the journalists, social media is offering a way to look at multiple perspectives of a story, but even to the people. Let me take a few examples of a few bigger stories that we've seen over the past 1-2 years. The Me Too movement, the way that's been amplified and the way the coverage that's been done and the way people perceive that entire story or the entire movement, that's had a significant impact. And look at, for instance, the George Floyd story. It had social media not been there, that issue probably wouldn't have been amplified to such an extent, or the voices we heard or the perspectives we saw from the people on the ground who actually put out videos or whatever, which kind of added to the entire story, that wouldn't have happened actually. So it's a lot of, it's not just for the journalists which is offering, the social media is putting out a way to look at a story from different perspectives, but also people. That comes back to the point where Paul had mentioned about accountability. So also a lot of people, when a story is covered from a particular side or particular way, a lot of people or audience wouldn't want it that way or would want to see another side. And that's when they talk to the journalist, they talk to the journalist who's written the story. So it has also made journalism quite interactive. Back in the day of newspaper or only television where audience would have perceived or consumed the news, the interaction between the journalist and the audience or the reader was quite limited. But that's now happening on social media. Yes, that will also pave way to a lot of trolling, a lot, because a lot of vested interest sandwiched on social media, especially when you're covering politics and all. You write about party A, party B would definitely be upset about it. So that's a different story altogether. But the interaction that's it is enabled between journalists and users, that's a little it's slightly positive, considering the fact that the dependence on social media is somewhere around pull journalists away from the ground reporting. You know, the journalists should never hesitate to pick up a call up the source, go to the ground. That's kind of definitely reduced a bit from the time social media is there, because it's, again, it's all a fast-paced world. Your videos are on WhatsApp. Earlier, you know, decades ago, TV was such that journalists used to go onto the ground, record, come back, then send the tape to the production team, then look at the footage and then go on air. But now I can directly go to the spot, you know, get onto one of the social media platforms, do a live stream, and then, you know, my audience can directly look at me from there. So at a time when it's pulling away, slightly away from the ground reporting, these kind of making it a little interactive with the audience who are consuming our news could be a little of help to the journalists as well.
So what I would like to add is that social media has actually helped certain sections of society to have a platform. For instance, because traditional media, the representation of minority communities within the newsroom is actually still a problematic area. It is not often addressed also. But it has allowed a new generation of Dalit youth to start their own media house. For instance, one is Dalit, the Dalit camera. It started as a Facebook page. Now they are going into the, you know, they are started reporting, and it's all from the eyes of the particular communities, often not written about in the mainstream media. So it has actually paved the way, but is also a reflection about the shortcomings of traditional media too. The adaptability to understand that there are shortcomings in our own reporting, that understanding also has to come for the traditional media to make the change. Because you have a lot of readers who are moving towards smaller news media outlets, which they believe will be addressing their particular issues. Moving to another thing, like what Paul pointed out about accountability, even Ruchika pointed out about accountability. As a journalist, the only thing that you have is your accountability.
Yeah.
If your credibility is gone, then you are then nobody's going to take you seriously. So, so in a way, when you interact with your readers, you understand who your readers are. If somebody has a problem, they reach out to you directly on your DM and say, "Hey, sir, could you please write about this particular issue?" Maybe you can't write. You point it out to your colleague. That never used to happen when I worked in the newspaper. I never knew who was reading my news. Although I keep writing, I do not know who my readers are, what my readers want, who the public are from the particular beat who are suffering from that. No idea. Social media has helped change that. As new reporters who are joining the field, it is very important that you segregate your personal life from your professional life and use the social media only for your professional use. That's my view on it. So that you can connect with people and build your credibility as you move through your career. The 2 points which I'm using.
Thank you, Mr. Mithun. So that actually brings us to this question of, now, what are journalists supposed to do in this, this new era of journalism, and how is that different from what they used to do in the past? Now, one thing, of course, is at the, you know, basic level of skills itself, that today we are journalists are expected to have very different skill sets, or much larger skill sets than what people who used to work only in newspapers or only as broadcast journalists used to have. And but apart from that, there is this question where, you know, people used to ask that now that everybody can be a journalist, now that anyone can tweet, anyone can publish a blog, what's the difference between a professional journalist and, you know, any random person on the street? So why should you go through a journalism program? You know, there were all these questions raised now that this is a new era and so on. But now, as I'm sure you all agree, what we see is actually a much greater need for professional journalism education and for professional journalists, because the democratization of access has actually led to a lot of issues around defining news, how to actually find news, how to follow leads and sources. And this has become much more important today, you know, that rather than the opposite. So in that sense, I just wanted to open it up to what you all think about the changing role of the journalist, I mean, one other criticism is that now, you know, people are kind of stuck in this bubble of Twitter. The journalists just follow each other, follow political leaders, and the hard work on of what is called boots on the ground is not being done. You can sit and, you know, just write a story based on tweets. In fact, one thing I ask my students to do is to just count the number of Twitter sources that today's newspaper has, and you'll be surprised how most stories lead with so-and-so tweeted this today, you know, rather than actual, and press releases are also on Twitter now, so your job has become, so that way, you know, that's the other aspect of it, how much that has changed the journalists, you know, working style, and what, how journalists have to change to adapt to this new environment. Yeah, Professor Dakshinamurthy, maybe you can.
You know, we have reached a point where we need to very carefully differentiate social media and journalism. Okay, social media, like access to social media and saying what you want, could be called journalism. But journalism is not only social media. So in that sense, journalism, you know, the core of journalism really is unchanged. It's not really, there's no change in journalism. Let me put it that way. The form have changed. But at the core, as a journalist, your job is to get credible information to the people at large. You are supposed to access information which people normally cannot access. And then you are supposed to bring it into the public space for discussion in a democratic society. Okay, so we should be very careful, because social media is not entirely journalism. And journalism is not only social media. So let's make that differentiation very, very clear. Because if you look at social media, okay, you can spin a piece on WhatsApp sitting in your backyard on an easy chair saying how eating tulsi leaf will ward you from getting COVID-19. And then you give a long explanation as to how this traditional herb is going to make you feel fine, you know, no COVID, no nothing. And then you put it out into the open. But as a journalist, I simply cannot do that. Because number one, there are certain rules by which you play. For instance, if I have to do the same story, that same tulsi should be checked, should be tested, should go through clinical trials, and there should be a data which backs the finding. And finally, and most importantly, it should appear in a peer-reviewed journal, which is widely accepted. After that, you can start eating tulsi and feel happy about COVID-19. But people, you know, just want the shortcut. You know, they just want simple feel-good information. Okay, so, and then, you know, what social media does, which journalism does not, is that social media plays to the proclivities of people. You see, as people, all of us are not rational. You know, we have all kinds of our own beliefs. You know, we have a lot of, the way we think about things. We feel that if there is a solar eclipse, the sun hides the moon, then everybody has to go take a bath. We cannot do this. We cannot do that. Well, there is absolutely no scientific evidence to prove this connection. But then everybody does it. So you write something on social media, there is no account. Accountability, mind you, because you can write in any name, you can write, you can hide behind any car. But journalism is not that. If I tomorrow write a news story in the Hindu saying, please, tomorrow there is a solar eclipse, don't come out of your homes, take a bath after the eclipse, what will happen to the newspaper? No, what will happen to the readers? So let's, while we accept that social media is kind of journalism, let's be very clear that these two are not the same things. And journalism still needs a certain kind of training. It still needs that expertise. It still needs a certain kind of, it has to follow certain rules. And only then it becomes journalism. And I think as we go forward, this differentiation is something that we must be very, very clear about. Yeah, yeah, please, the next one. Yeah.
If I can.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, so talking about the skill sets, you were asking about the skill sets. In the short span, in the introduction, I told you, in the last 6 years itself, I've seen so much transformation. I can imagine what Professor Dakshinamurthy has actually seen in the several decades. In fact, when I joined Times Now, I had 6 people as part of my crew. 6 people, that is 1 camera person, 1 OB engineer, 1 technician, and 1 person just to look at the cables when the live is going on. So now, over a period of time, the OB van, that is the outside broadcasting van itself, disappeared, and now they have small bags which are called a live view kits. After that, the technician disappeared, OB engineer disappeared, and then finally we had only the camera person. Now the platform that I work for, when I go out reporting, I'm alone. I hold the camera myself, I do the live myself. The output is, I was giving a live back then, I'm giving a live today as well. So that's the kind of transformation in terms of skill sets. Yes, I did not know how to hold a camera before because my cameraman did it. I did not know the technicalities, but it's much more simple today. The click of a button can take you live. All you need is a good internet connection and a good camera. So it is not rocket science that you cannot learn. We have all done it and we are still doing it. We are learning on a daily basis. So the students don't need to be worried about learning the new skill sets. But yes, there are some things that you can imbibe at an early stage, because at IIGN, when we were there, they kept telling us how Twitter is very important. And around 6-7 years back, it wasn't that important. We all created a profile just for the sake of it, but we never was active on Twitter. Once we joined journalism, we realized how important Twitter is. And today on a daily basis, we spend so much time on Twitter because that's where we share our stories, we get information. So these kind of things that your college tells you might sound like you don't really need it, but in the long run, we really realized how important it is. Shoe leather, like you pointed out, sir, a very important thing. And back in college, every story that we did, they would tell us to write where all we visited, who all we spoke to, so that they know exactly. Yeah. It's not armchair reporting. And here, if I'm covering, for example, the Kerala elections, I just came back from Kerala. So for Kerala elections, I could have sat in Hyderabad and done stories just by calling. But if you look into the copies done by any journalist, a person on the field, there is life in the copy. There's color in the copy. The kind of the description, the noise. Like I read a copy in which it said the blaring sound of the election campaigning. He entered the village and he heard a jeep going by, which was actually calling out to people to vote in favor of a particular candidate. So all those elements that you see, that is the life of the copy, and that comes only from the shoe leather. Social media has made it a lot easier for us. Why not? For example, earlier to get a reaction from the Congress chief, I had to actually travel all the way to his house, go there, take an appointment, meet him, and then come back, then put out the story. But now I just give him a call. He sends me a video on WhatsApp saying what he has to convey. And within around 10-15 minutes, the story is out. Why not? The senior editors might say, why should you do it that way? But it has made life so much easier. Why do I need to spend 2 hours to do it? Yes, there are flip sides. Like you need to add color to your copy. But at the same time, a lot of work has now become much more less laborious because of social media.
I'd like to quickly come in here.
Yeah.
You know, if to the question of what differentiates you, why should you be a journalist? Why should you be trained professionally when people are already doing it on social media? I think, like Professor Dakshinmurthy sir also pointed out, there's a lot of skill set that's required. For instance, if you're covering a certain story which involves 5 different parties, it is your responsibility to talk to all the 5 sides and present that version. You cannot afford to have a vested interest. You should be the most probably neutral figure covering that particular story. That is what differentiates you from those handles of social media that just put out one side of the story. So any story you pick, from crime to civic issue or anything, it is your responsibility to present all the sides. Also, the research that comes in, the background, if it's a political story, all that amount of hard work you put in when you put out a story, that differentiates you from any random social media and that's just shooting a video and tweeting about it. Also, like sir mentioned, social media is it's not the only kind of journalism we're looking at. Ground reporting is still a very essential part. For instance, a quick example that I want to give, a few weeks we had communal class, small town in Telangana called Bhansa, which is on the border of Telangana and Maharashtra district. So Bhansa is the only town in Telangana which is seen repeated in as soon there was a communal clash in the last 2-3 years. So a few weeks ago when there was an incident of a communal clash, this was a communal clash between 2 communities. There were messages on social media saying, in the neighboring the sexual assault on a minor girl by another community member in retaliation to the clash. And that's so much. Traveled to Bhansa and I spoke to people there, the police there. That's when we come to know that those 2 incidents were not related at all. And I went, when I mentioned this in my story, I still got a lot of trolls social media by Western downplay that, oh, I'm siding with one particular community. So all this is something that will differentiate you. You go to the ground, you talk to all the sides of people. And then you put out anything that when it comes to skill set, it's no longer a TV journalist, no longer a journalist. Fortunately, the digital turn that we're looking at has forced all of us to be a multimedia journalist. You need to know how to operate your mobile camera. You need to know how to be active on social media. You need to know the language. You need to write. And I'm sorry if you're working for an English publication and you say, I can't probably write like this. That's not an excuse anymore. You need to shoot your own stuff, capture photographs, take bites. That's all the skills that young journalists as of today need to know. You can't just be, I like writing, so I'll just stick to writing. The convergence has become mandatory. What earlier decades ago was an option or probably was a niche, that's not the case anymore. But ground reporting and credibility are the most important part of any journalist. You've gone the years of work that you've built, that's to all the sides of the people. Presenting the story in the most neutral form is something that you will have as your skill.
Yeah, thanks, Rishika. That's, that's quite true, actually, from what Professor Dakshinamurthy was also saying, and Paul and Rishika was saying, is that although now we're entering a phase of convergent journalism that, you know, you're all students who are entering the field now are expected to have much bigger skill sets than what was expected earlier, the core of the craft of journalism has not changed. And in fact, that core is even more important today because there is so much scrutiny of journalists, so much more accountability because of the democratization that the new kind of journalism has led to. And remember, at the core, we still call reporting, you know, making stories. So journalists work on stories, and that craft of telling stories using language is something that's still at the heart of journalism, even if the, you know, the technical means have changed, even if the story is no longer on paper or broadcast on television, but the core of that craft has changed, has remained the same. Mithun, did you want to add anything to this question of skills or? Yeah. If not, we can also open this up to questions that students may have. Okay, I have, sorry.
What happened to Mithun's?
I think it says he's muted. I'm not sure how that is. I think you can unmute.
Mithun, unmute him.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I think.
You can hear me? Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So about the skill sets that differentiate, I just wanted to let you, the young journalists who are considering journalism as an option, do not be afraid. You will pick up the skills eventually. So do not think that you need great skills to this thing. It'll come naturally over time. Be patient with yourself. Do not beat yourself up for it. The basic things that you learn is that you need to be useful for a newsroom, in the sense that when a picture comes, whether it is accurate, you have to reverse engineer that picture. There is a way to see where the source of information came from, how to differentiate a press release from a fake press release. One thing which I wanted to point out is that earlier when we started journalism, like how Paul said, Twitter was not a great tool. Neither was Facebook used as a means. Now every police station, every government has got their press releases and everything coming out through those channels. So official press releases and all, you will get like that. Often what happens is that so your job is not just to put out press releases. As a journalist, you have to pick up other skills to see what they are saying is also true or not. That's where your people skills, your ability to, like Rishika said, go to the ground, talk to people, all that complements it. Social media is only a tool. It does not define journalism. So just always keep that in mind. Use it for positive, this thing, but don't be a slave to it.
Yeah, thanks, Mithun. That's really important and good advice for any students aspiring to enter the field. So as I was saying, we can open it up to if students have any questions for the panelists or about the, you know, the topic and the field in general, we can take those. Or you know, anyone else in the audience, even if you're not a student.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, can we say that in India, journalism is a transparency? Because, sir, in as compared to the European countries are saying that if a politician did the mistake, they publicly saying that in the form of writing, in the form of newspaper, they're saying that they corrupted, the politician corrupted, the institution corrupted. But India, sir, if you come to the India, I observed, sir, I'm from Nizam College, sir, MA English student. I observed that in India, there is no transparency in the journalism, sir, because the politicians are doing mistakes and they're paying money to the journalism and they're unable to bring the fact into the public. So what do you say about this, sir?
Yeah, anyone wants to take that? I think we were talking about, Mithun, you wanted to say something. Sorry, I think you are muted again. Yes.
Hi. Dasari. Hi. Thank you for raising the question. See, the reason why you feel that journalism is there is no transparency is because you have to look at the source of the information, which news outlet you are getting your information from. News media, at the end of the day, we all require our salary. So how is a news organization funded comes a question. So if you are looking at a news, if you're consuming news from an organization which is funded by a political party or funded by an individual who has ties to a political party, then the news that you consume will serve only those people. You understand? I don't want to take names, but over here, at least in vernacular media in Telugu, in the both the Telugu states, the media is completely. The news media is completely owned by certain political parties or by people associated to political parties. So transparency is out of the question. You will have to find alternate means to find accurate information. Is what I would suggest.
You know what I will let me intervene at this point. See, Dasari, I think, was the person who asked this question. There is transparency in India. You know, it's not like there is no transparency. You know, I think you are asking a general question about if, let's say, a minister does something wrong, why isn't the minister getting exposed? Well, there is a process. You know, it happens over a period of time, but there have been scores of instances in the past where ministers have got exposed, they have resigned, some of them have even gone to jail. So it's not correct to say that there is no transparency in the Indian media. There is. And, you know, it works differently to some extent, say, from media in Europe or the US. But, you know, and some people, I agree with you, some people get away with, with what they do. And many people don't get away also. They eventually get trapped and they have to resign. And there are, simply scores of examples, you know. So I don't know what, if you have any specific instance in mind about any particular minister or any particular thing, then maybe we can look at it. But as a broad sweeping statement, it's not correct. I mean, Indian media does expose people. There's no, I don't think we have reached that point as yet when we hide things.
Yeah, thank you, sir. I think to answer this question, we would also need to look at a whole, you know, other aspects of ownership, political economy, all these things, which, you know, we won't, this venue, we don't have the scope for that.
No, but just a point, You know, about the ownership. See, for instance, let's assume that a particular media house is owned by a politician who gets compromised in something. There are other media houses which will expose him. Even if this particular media house doesn't, there are others to do it. So the crowd makes up for the absence of one entity. Sorry, please continue.
Yeah, that's very true. Yeah, but I mean, a lot of these questions are also, you know, much larger social questions, you know, which affect journalism in a broader way as well, not just, you know, within our topic for today. But yeah, that's, I mean, that's a very true observation about that we still have, you know, mechanisms in place for our media to function in, you know, as a, at the way it should in a democratic society. So, I mean, hopefully we will keep it that way. In the changing scenario as well. Any other questions regarding, you know, for if any of you want to enter the field or in general about the influence of social media on journalism?
Hello.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Sorry. Yeah, so I'm Hanvi and I would like to ask a question. So we all know that trolling is has become a very common thing. Like everything we do is criticized by people. And since you're a journalist, you are reporting and telling people about a lot of things, there are people who might accuse you of being biased or who might not like what your views are. Like, and they might troll you. How do you deal with it?
Nothing, you know, I can give one quick example. The other day I wrote something about, I think Kunal Kamra and, you know, when he was, you know, prosecuted and he was to be approached by the Supreme Court. So I wrote some long piece on humor and et cetera, et cetera. So one of the response to that was the author is of a very sick mind. And he, you know, or something to that effect, you know. So it was very amusing. So it just depends on how you take it, you know. I mean, of course, it can sometimes get very nasty. Then, I don't know. I mean, it can be quite painful. But, well, you just have to learn to live with it. I don't see any other way out of this.
Yeah. I think
that's my short.
Yeah. If I could just comment.
Yeah, Rishika and then Paul.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's obvious. Very difficult. You worry, you make sure you present it the most neutral way. You still have people trolling you. Now, these are not just social media bots which are trolling you. There are trolls from really, you know, educated backgrounds, people in different fields who are doing that. You know, I've had many times for covering Tony that was not in lines with them. It definitely takes a toll on you mentally. I'm not going to say it's going to be like just be thick-skinned and just not look at social media when we're depending on it so much as a validation. Also, like Mithun mentioned, probably how many people are watching our story, reading our story, but now you get appreciated on social media. People DM us, I like your work. At the same time, when you look at all of this and feel sort of validated to an extent, it's obvious that you will get mentally affected by all of things when people troll you. So I think it comes with over a period of time when you are working, but essentially what is very important is that you stick to your work. I mean, both Paul and I have been, we've been trolled a lot, especially during the time of elections, when you are covering elections, political parties, it's the time for them. They just troll you if you present a story within the most neutral way. So it comes of time, but thick skin, that's, you have to get over it. It does take a toll on you mentally, but if you focus a lot on your work and if you keep doing what you think is, you know, sticking, making you stick to the core, what you've learned in your college or the core of journalism, that should be fine actually.
Hanvi, very important question, because initially I would go through every comment on my stories and I would take it at heart. I would really get disappointed. And then eventually, I think both of us, like Rishika said, we learn because we keep discussing about how badly we've got trolled for a story. And then later I realize the more amount of trolling you get, it only shows that your story has had an impact. So that satisfaction that it gives you, that is very encouraging for you to go on and do the next story. And it's so bad, the online world, that trolling is so common that they draw parallels. For example, the recent story that I did from Andhra about how there is no threat to Christianity or the minorities. That was, it was about temple attacks, the story. So they drew parallels saying, because I'm a Christian, I'm saying temple attacks are not taking place. So they draw your religion, they draw your ethnicity. They say that I'm not from Hyderabad. I'm born and brought up in Hyderabad, but I'm originally from Kerala. So they say, why is an outsider commenting on stories from Andhra, Telangana? So doesn't me being born in Hyderabad make me a Hyderabadi? So there are several questions that keep, every time I do a negative story about Telangana, I get trolled saying outsider commenting on Telangana. So that's the kind of, they find out your lineage, they find out your education, they find out everything from your social media handles. But then now I think we've reached a point where we just laugh about it. But yes, I still go through all the comments on my stories because it is critical way of looking at your stories. A lot of people have feedback, which is great feedback. Often you miss out on a small point, which is actually something that needs to be included. Then I talk to my editor and ensure that that point is included. So there are a lot of people who give constructive feedback. I still go through all my comments for that. And I simply laugh at all the trolling that goes on. It's fun. Beyond a point, it just gets fun because people keep doing it and you're just so used to it.
I would highly recommend people who are getting trolled to use the use the mute button. Don't be shy about using it. You should just mute the trolls. So it was better to not engage or feed the troll. That's my experience, because if somebody trolls me, I wrote one story about RSS funding, and it was a lot of trolls came. So I just mute. I don't want to destroy my mental peace. I just move on to the next story. I don't wait for the feedback from trolls. If there's a genuine feedback, yes, how Paul said, you go through it, but don't put it inside your, don't let it affect you. Mute and move on.
There is no other option other than muting that also, because you can't let them come in the middle of your work. I still remember three random people on social media. This was not even for my story. This was not even a reply to my tweet. It was a random thread where three men started discussing how credible am I as a journalist. And I'm tagged in every tweet. So for a person, I asked, hey, do you know Rishika Sadam? She's just moved to this organization. How credible is she? How biased is she? Which political party is she affiliated to? Then person B, all three of them don't follow me. This is not even for my story. It was just a random thread I was at. He says, let's wait and watch. She's not from Telangana. She's from Delhi. I don't know where this came from. So yeah, this outsider covering Telangana, but I'm born in Telangana. She's not from Telangana. And the person C says, she has enough amount of experience in the field. Even if she's biased to me, she would show it. She'll very subtly do her agenda. So let's follow her work. So this is random, some 60 tweets where I'm tagged in every one of them. This was, you just read for fun, mute it and get on with your day. That's the only advice that can come to, you know, journalists who are now looking at social media so much. So yeah.
I think there are a couple of questions on chat, sir.
Yeah, I was just looking at them, and maybe we can end with addressing those two questions. But before, I just wanted to, I mean, this is actually very good advice. I just wanted to reinforce what, you know, the panelists have just said, that, you know, developing a thick skin and looking at the positive side of criticism, that, you know, if people are trolling you, that means your work has had an impact. Those are two good attitudes to have for any young journalist. Now, in the interest of time, maybe we can go to these two very specific questions about careers and practicing journalism that is Pratyusha has put in the chat box. And then, so Pratyusha is asking about the advisability of doing a postgraduate degree, whether it's advisable, what is the role of a specialized MA or a postgraduate program in journalism versus doing a political science or a sociology degree. So it's a career sort of question. This is a very common question, I think, that students have about the value of a specialized technical degree versus a broader liberal social science degree. And I'll just look at the other question as well. Maybe you can address it together. The other one is from Darakshan Razvi, who is asking about what young people can do. It is not, yeah. So the scope for joining new media companies, and probably this, when addressing this question, we can also look at the scope for entrepreneurship in journalism today that social media offers for setting up on your own, the opportunities in newer, companies that are coming up, new forms of journalism, and such as, you know, many of our panelists today are from new web portals which didn't exist earlier. So maybe we could just speak a little bit about those opportunities as well. Yeah, Professor Dakshinamurthy, maybe you can address the question about the degree. Yeah,
yeah. I know as far as the, if you do BA in journalism and mass media and you want to do an MA, if you have decided to do an MA, it is always, it's good to see what your long-term goal is. For instance, if you are a person who wants to do, let's say, PhD in communications, then you should continue to do MA in communication or MA in journalism. But if you want to do MA and then come into journalism field as a journalist, then it would make sense for you to pick up a specialized field like sociology or political science or economics or whatever. Because otherwise what happens is that if it's too general, then you it will be a problem for you to know anything specifically. It's become too general. So if you're for BA, it's okay. But when you do your MA, my suggestion is pick up anything that is a specialization. Or the only reason why you do a MA in communication is if you want to do a PhD in communication, then it's fine. So this is the short answer to that. As far as joining the next question, as far as joining popular news companies, it's actually fairly simple. What, when you're doing your, I don't know whether the audience now, they are journalism students. If they are, my suggestion to you is step out into the city, do some stories. Okay, try or at least try to do stories. And if your story is good, any of the companies will take it. You have News Minute, they may take it. I know I'm part of another organization called the Federal. We take it. You can even give it to anyone else. So if it's a good story, there is always a demand for it. And as a student, my suggestion to you is don't just go by what happens in the classroom. Please step out and think of your own things to do. You can interview people. You can do features. You can do many things. So when you do that, and then when you finish your course, you are already, you have an advantage. You have a big advantage because you can show this from your portfolio. And then editors will always be interested in what you have done and then give you a chance. So it's as simple as that. Yeah. I mean, if there's anyone else who can, this is my two quick answers to this.
I think about MA things are rightly answered. In fact, it'd be interesting to note how Mithun, Rishika and I, all three of us are engineers who just did a PGDM in journalism and then came to journalism. So we don't even have a broader experience in journalism. It is only our post-graduation PGDM that we did in journalism, all three of us. So people who want a job in journalism, a PGDM would also suffice what I wanted to add. And about the second question, I don't really agree with that because a lot of newsroom, they want young people. In fact, in News Minute or I was in Times Now as well, the average age would be between 26 to around 30, 32. That's the age. That is when, straight out of college, a lot of news organizations really want young people because they are the ones who can be molded in the way the organization wants. They're ready to run around. They're paid less. So it perfectly works for news organizations. So it's very easy to get a job if you have actually the right kind of skill sets. So work on your skill sets. Don't worry about the job. A lot of people who join IIJNM also keep reaching out to us saying, is it easy to get placed from IIJNM? I said, irrespective of the college. Yes, the college brings in a lot of companies. So that is important. Apart from that, it's only your skill set. So instead of worrying about whether you will land getting a good job, I think you should just work on your skill sets and that will land you in a job.
I totally agree with what Paul has said. Work on your skill set. Pick up a few other skills too. It's about what you bring to the table that makes you valuable to your newsroom. Like if you are a guy who can code, you can even better. You can do data storage. If you know how to scrape data using Python, even better. You can build databases for your organization, do stories based off that. So it's about what you want to do and what kind of journalism you want to do, what kind of skills you want to do. Just a degree, I don't believe in degrees because my engineering degree is not used to me. Apart from me understanding technology a little bit, it's my PGDM that helped me get a job. So learn the skills. That's what I would say.
Yeah, thank you. That's really good advice. And I hope it answers some of the other questions that I've seen in the chat box also regarding programs to follow, postgraduate degrees and diplomas and so on. I think one of the students is asking the panelists to share their Twitter handles, if you all would want to. Astha Kochar is asking, I don't know how we are doing on time, Sangeeta ma'am, and I don't know if you can take another question or...
If the panelists are okay, we should be able to take another
question. So I think there are other questions as well that have to do with, the courses that are most suitable for a career in journalism. But as Mithun just pointed out, you know, the skills are actually far more important. Developing skills, developing a portfolio of work, whether it's writing or, you know, any other kind of work, is far more important than what specific degree you'll do. And as Professor Dakshinamurthy pointed out, it's actually good to have a social science degree, because it gives you knowledge that is much more useful than having a mass communication master's, which is useful if you want to study media, not, you know, practice as a journalist. Maybe one more question and then we can wrap it up. Sadia Asim is asking in the chat box, TV journalist Ravish Kumar once stated, one doesn't die only when they're buried or cremated. The fear of not being able to freely write, speak, or hear is also a form of death. So this is an important question. I think we addressed it a little bit during the discussion, but maybe if somebody wants to take and end with this question on narrowing independence in the field of journalism, you know, the pressures that young journalists will face. I think it's an important question because, unlike people who have been in the field for a while, students who are just thrown into this field in today's challenging environment might need some advice on how to deal with this, these pressures. Yeah.
You know, I can just quickly, what I can say is that journalism, I'm talking of real journalism, is always seen as a threat by institutions, by governments. Okay, please remember that journalism, media always works under pressure, not just today, but has always been that way. The moment any journalist or any news story challenges a power or, you know, some authority, there is going to be pressure on the media to conform. So this is an ongoing battle. It will keep happening. In fact, now this particular government is bringing in new rules to rein in news websites, rein in social media platforms, you know, like the OTT platforms. And they're coming up with all these things just to, and there is within the journalist community, there is a lot of skepticism about why the government is doing these things. And it's, but then the point is that these are challenges that will keep coming, and it's for the media to take them on as and when they come. So, you do what you need to do. That's it.
I think I'd quickly like to come here. For young journalists also, there's a lot of pressure, because this question was particularly for young journalists when you enter a newsroom, like Professor Dakshinamurthy pointed out. This is an ongoing process. It's been in that way. And of course, we must also understand a lot more people are now aware about how the control or probably the influence on journalism is there, or the control on journalism is there. That is also due to social media, which is being amplified. All the voices are being heard. But otherwise, young journalists will also have pressure when they enter a newsroom. There is going to be a kind of pressure, the kind of independence you expect or you see during your course. Probably that might not be the situation, but that is how you will learn. And after a point, you will identify, you will know your niche, as in what you would want to do, how, what kind of a voice you want to have. And that will help you make your own way going forward, set your own target or make your own way or chalk out that. So pressure is definitely going to be there, but that will be a learning point definitely.
Thanks, Rishika and Professor Dakshinamurthy. Srivani ma'am, did you have something to add? I think I saw a raised hand.
I'm sorry, it was a mistake.
Okay, no problem. Yeah. Okay, so yeah, so I mean, that's a good note to maybe wrap up today's discussion. These pressures, as Professor Dakshinamurthy pointed out, have always been there in some form or other. So it is not something that, that's something that the media has to face collectively, the journalists will have to face up to when they enter the field. Yeah, if there are any last words, maybe we can have them from the panelists. Otherwise, we can wrap up and I can hand over to the... So maybe just one last word of advice from all four of you and then we can wrap it up.
Well, what I can simply say is that we are at a very exciting time in journalism, and I think we must look at the brighter side and the positive side and make use of all the opportunities. I'm telling you one thing very, very categorically. The kind of opportunities that you have today was unthinkable 30 years ago. You had to stand outside newspaper offices to get a job and hope in the hot sun, wait to see the editor. It was very, very, very tough. But today you have absolutely great opportunities. Please make full use of it and all the very best to all of you.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, Paul, did you have...
Very simple. I would just say work on your skill sets. And don't be disheartened by people saying journalism is sold out. It is not sold out. There are a lot of organizations that are doing a good job and a lot of scope for writing. So that shouldn't be a reason why you shouldn't take up journalism. You can still go out there, write stories that make a difference and choose your organization wisely. And also do internship with any organization. The more internships you do, please reach out to people. There are a lot of opportunities. I'm telling you this because especially the digital space, people take a lot of interns. So the more organizations you work, you get to know the structure, how it works, the kind of news. It gives you a broader perspective. So reach out to people. Very easy to reach out to people on Twitter, anywhere on social media or contacts. Just reach out to any journalist. They can put you through an internship and take up opportunities so that you get a broader idea about where to go.
Thank you, Paul. Rishika, did you have something to add, like as last words?
Sorry, was it for me?
Yeah, just in case if you had any last words of advice before we end.
Yes, a quick line. You're all young journalism students who are wanting to enter the field. I know there could be, it could seem like a lot of chaos in your region. There's no independence, there's no transparency, it's sold out, it's dead. That's not the case. We are all here and the people from decades, we're all joining. We have a future. You have a future. So, don't whatever you learn a core of journalism that will always help you, that should always remain with you. And it's all about an experience. A degree is just probably a launch pad and it will just expose you to the field. But every day is going to be a learning point and there's going to be so much to learn. So that is what you need to be excited about. This, starting from this day, starting from tomorrow, you would learn so much in the coming years in terms of jobs, in terms of experience. So I'd only like to wish all the students all the very best, and every journalist on Twitter or social media very approachable. Do ask them any queries you have, get into internships, do a lot of work, get onto the ground, talk to people. You can only make your editor happy with your stories and your work. That's it. All the very best.
Thank you, Rishika. Mithun, did you want to?
I just wanted to tell the young journalists, whoever are listening, that do not be shy about sending your pitches to editors. You know, you might not even be doing internship there, but if you have a story which you have reported, feel free to send a 30-word pitch to that editor saying that, or to the bureau chief of that city, to say that, hey, I have a story, would you please be interested in publishing? Take that effort. It's at the end of the day, it is upon you to take that effort. And when you keep doing more stories, you eventually will, the first few stories will be difficult. Maybe the editors may not be kind to you, or they may not look, but they will eventually pick up. It will work out for you. Just keep trying.
Thank you, Mithun. And it's it's wonderful to end on such a hopeful note, despite all the discussion we've had about the threats and the flip side of all the the influence that social media has had on journalism and so on. That journalism is still at its core, it's still very much alive and well, and it's very welcoming to new talent, and there's many more opportunities today than you would have ever had in the past. So I know there are some more questions in the chat box that maybe you can all address individually by scrolling through them, but I think here we can end the discussion itself. And I just wanted to also thank all of you for your wonderful insights and inputs, and I myself have learned a lot, so that is it's always wonderful to talk to a practicing journalist. That's all. I also wanted to thank Sunitha Ma'am and St. Anne's College for thinking of me to moderate this panel as well. So
can I put one last question? Since
yes,
you are talking about that note of hope, can we reinforce that note of hope in the students? If one of you can just give us one story of a major breakthrough you got, and you know, that just opened up this career to you. So that'll really give the students a feeling like we can do it too. So it's like any one of you can give one. You got that break and you made it a practical opening that just, or am I,
I'm sorry, there's an audio disturbance. I couldn't hear you.
No, just to reinforce Dr. Srinivas's thing of ending on a note of hope. I know you've worked and come a long way and established yourselves, though it's you all are a young team. But can you end with one story of hope, that ray of hope, that point when you made a breakthrough that, can inspire our students, that point, anyone. So,
Paul, I, Mithun, we're all engineers, we're all engineering graduates. And imagine when we've actually left engineering and we've all completed engineering and what kind of lucrative jobs engineering offers. There's an option to go to the US. That's Hyderabad sends the maximum number of students to the United States of America. It's so lucrative there. And we took a shift. We came to a college where there were people from a mass communication background. It was such a tough time for all of us. I mean, I'm sure all of us had it in our mind, would we be even able to finish the course? Will we even get a job? Would we be able to become a journalist anytime? Because that's a tough time, taking an entire shift of 4 years. But look here, today we are here. So there's definitely hope. It's just the amount of work you put in. It will look tough. Like Mithun also said, it's going to be tough. It's not going to be easy. But once you're constantly working towards it, I don't see a reason why any of you would not succeed if you put in that effort.
Guys, whoever's listening, I just want to let you know, I finished engineering and I went abroad and I worked for 2 years. As an engineer in a construction company, and then
here
I quit my job. Did a quit my job, took a complete 360 degree turn and just 180 degree turn, and just came back to India to pursue journalism. Was it worth it? Hell yes! I've never been happier in my life, and I'm proud of the work I do. So yeah, it's about what you want. If this field is for you, then you will do absolutely fine. You will not give up. You will keep trying. It's a matter of keeping on trying if you really have the will for.
All then.
Actually, when I joined journalism, that was in 1982. Okay, so there were no journalism colleges like what you see today. So I had no idea what journalism was, but I knew I wanted to be one. So I just imagined that this must be what it should be. And, I just took a chance. And in fact, in 82, I did a story which investigated the spread of social forestry in Karnataka. And it became a huge issue. And, it led to a lot of protests and all that. And this was the first time me and a friend of mine, both of us were still students. We went to a particular spot outside Bangalore City. We took pictures. We, spoke to experts. And said how this the replacement of traditional trees by eucalyptus trees were was harming the soil, and that story was carried very well in Indian Express, and in fact it was a half a page story with photographs and all that, and the editor took the story and then said please meet me after your exams. So I finished my exams on Friday, and on Monday I was in Indian Express.
Great. So, very hard. Sangeeta, that was a lovely team that you put together for us. Mr. Paul, Rishika, Mr. Mithun, of course, the wise wisdom of Mr. Dakshinamurthy with his experience over the years. Thank you so much. And Dr. Srinivas, I think that our choice was apt in roping in an academician. so patiently listening. I think someone like me would have been rushing in with words when you gave them their platform, I think. But, Sangeeta, thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot.
Any more words to say? And I'll ask Mrs. Revathi to propose a word of thanks. Mrs. Revathi?
Yes, ma'am, I'm here. Very good afternoon to one and all. According to St. Ambrose, no duty is more urgent than that of returning thanks. So I'm delighted to have been given the pleasant duty of delivering the vote of thanks this morning. So on behalf of the Department of English, and I on my own behalf would like to thank our distinguished speakers on the panel, Ms. Rishika Sadam, Special Correspondent, The Print, Mr. Paul Uman, Special Correspondent, The News Minute, APN Telangana, Mr. Mithun MK, Senior Reporter and Overseas In-Depth Reportage at The News Minute, Mr. KS Dakshinamurthy, Faculty Teaching covering International News, Science and Technology and Political Reporting at IIJNM, and our moderator, Professor Srinivas Lankala, Department of Communication, FLU, Hyderabad, Ms. Sangeeta Alwar, Professor, Department of English, IIJNM, for sparing their valuable time to enlighten us with their talk on the topic social media and its influence on journalism. I would also like to thank our correspondent, Sister Teresa, and our principal, Dr. Sister P. Amrita, for their unflinching support and guidance. And I'm thankful to Dr. Smita Astana, IQAC coordinator, for helping us by providing excellent facilities for the webinar. And a big thanks to all the delegates. I must mention a deep sense of appreciation for our student team for their unwavering support in organizing this event. Finally, I would like to take this opportunity to place on record a hearty thanks to Ms. Aparna for the technical support and Ms. Vani for the registrations and looking into feedback forms and certificates, and Ms. Pratyusha for looking into the logical support, and also the IQAC team, and Ms. Rashmi, Sarita, Kanaka, and all the student coordinators for their support, and a special thanks to Ms. Aparna again for this technical help. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Ma'am, unmute.
Sunita, ma'am, unmute.
Yeah, sorry. Can we have one
over to Sunita, ma'am?
If all of us put on our videos, whoever is here available.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. One quick picture. Yes.
I request all our participants to kindly turn on their videos for a picture. Yeah.
Thank you, Jerusha and Sakina. Vani, can you put on your video, please? Betty is there. Yes.
Yeah, 1 second.
Participants, whoever can, do put on your videos. Jerusha, are you sure you can? Thank you, Sina.
One last, 1 second. I'm done. One second. Yes, ma'am, I'm done.
Thanks once again to our panelists. Thank you, IIJNM. I think you've got a great team growing. Just imagine having your alumni coming back and doing all this for you. I think that says a lot about your institution. Thank you, Dr. Srinivas.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.